Yolumuz rica etmiş gibi koordinatı yürüyor. And the causes for your loss can be many, like infectious, inflammatory, neoplastic, metabolic, and so on. Of these, the 50% is due to hereditary loss, hereditary cause of hearing loss. Now, hereditary loss or hereditary hearing loss could be due to autosomal recessive, autosomal dominant, syndromal, inherited metabolic, X-linked, or mitochondrial. Of these, autosomal recessive is the most common cause. Now, the first most important syndrome is Waardenburg syndrome. Now, this accounts for most of the causes of congenital hearing losses. This is an autosomal dominant neuroectodermal syndrome which presents with striking features of white furlock of hair, heterochromia iris, and two different colored iris, pupil bow of upper lip, and sensorineural deafness. On the left hand side, this is one of our implanted patients. He was implanted 1.5 years back and is doing very well with the implant. Now, Waardenburg syndrome accounts for 3% of childhood hearing impairment. Its incidence is 1 in 4,000 life births and may present with unilateral or bilateral loss. Now, a child with Waardenburg syndrome, in addition to hearing loss, will also present with pigmentary features which are due to defects in tyrosine metabolism. He may have a white forelock of hair, heterochromia iris, that is two different colored iris. The mother may complain of premature graying of hair before the age of 10 years, vitiligo, and craniofacial features in the form of dystrophia cambium, that is lateral displacement of the inner canthi of the eye, a broad nasal root, and cynophrys, that is bushy eyebrows which meet in the midline. Something like this. He may also have aplasia of posterior semicircular canal, skeletal and vertebral anomalies in the form of broad mandible, elevation of shoulder blade, disorder of spine and supernumerary vertebrae, along with systemic features like ventricular septal defect, Hirschsprung disease, esophageal aphasia, and absence of vagina and eutrophia uteri. Waardenburg syndrome is divided into three types on the basis of lateral displacement of inner canthi of eye. Type 1 shows presence of lateral displacement of inner canthi of eye. In type 2, there is absence of dystrophia cambium. And type 3, in addition to the lateral displacement of inner canthi of eye, the child has microcephaly, skeletal abnormalities, and mental retardation. Now, the underlying defect is in this syndrome is mutation in certain genes. Now, type 1 and type 3 is due to mutation in PX3, which is present on chromosome 3. While type 2 is due to defect in microsomal transmission factor, which is present on chromosome 2. Now, both these genes are responsible for development of face and inner ear. And type 2 is the commonest of all three of these and presents with 50% of cases with sensorineural deafness. These patients have typical U-shaped audiogram, and histopathology shows total absence of organoid corti and absence of neurons of spinal canal. Moving on to the next syndrome, that is the long QT syndrome or the Jarrell-Lange-Nielsen syndrome. Now, this is one of the conditions which can be detected in utero if the doctor picks up irregular heart rate, fetal heart rate in the form of bradycardia during any one of the antenatal visits, and an ECG will confirm this condition after birth. Now, this is an autosomal recessive cardiomyopathy syndrome, which presents with congenital profound bilateral sensorineural deafness at birth and abnormal ECG in the form of prolonged QT interval. Now, the normal QT interval is less than 4-5 milliseconds. However, in this condition, the QT interval is more than 4-5 milliseconds. Thus, the cardiac muscle takes a longer than usual time to recharge between beats, which leads to irregular heartbeat, further leading to, which left untreated, leads to fainting attacks, seizures, and sudden death. Now, the underlying defect in this condition is mutation in certain genes which control the potassium channel. Now, mutation in these genes alters the ultrastructure and function of potassium channel. Thus, the flow of positively charged potassium ions is disrupted, which in the inner ear and the cardiac muscle, thus leading to hearing loss and irregular heart rate. Histopathology in these patients shows degeneration of sensory end organs of cochlea, degeneration of vestibular apparatus, spherical inclusion bodies in stria vascularis, degeneration of conducting system of heart, and narrowing of sinoatrial artery with atrial hypoplasia. Now the rhythm defects in these patients can be treated with the cardiac pacemakers and beta-adrenergic blockers, and hearing loss can be treated with cochlear implantation. Now a word here is that the cochlear implant does not interfere with bipolar pacemakers. Next syndrome is a Penrod syndrome, which is in which there is sentinel hearing loss, goiter, and inner ear deformity in the form of Mondini's dysplasia. Now Penrod syndrome is an autosomal recessive syndrome and is responsible for 7.5% of all congenital deafness. And it presents with sentinel hearing loss, goiter, that is thyroid swelling, which usually manifests post-puberty, that is after 10 to 12 years of age. Thus, the thyroid function is usually normal in children and with inner ear malformation in the form of large aqueduct syndrome and Mondini's dysplasia. Now, the underlying defect in this syndrome is a mutation in the sulfate ion transporter gene, which is the trigger of chromosome 7. This pathology shows a malformed cochlea, degenerative changes in inner ear, and endolymphatic high drops. Now, a Vera and a proton audiogram is done to detect the hearing loss, which will a function test should be done. Atrocity of temporal bone is very important in this case to look for the dilated vestibular aqueduct and to pick up the Mondini aplasia. Cochlear implants can be considered for those with severe to profound hearing loss. The diagnostic test here is the perforate discharge test, which detects the defect in organification of iodide, and thyroid function tests are performed, and any abnormality should be treated accordingly. Now the next group of syndrome is autorhodial amyotrophies. In this, the child presents with defect in the eye as well as ear. Most common this is the Usher's. The others are Corpine syndrome, which is deafness with retinal atrophy and dwarfism. Fogarn syndrome, that is non-syphilitic interstitial keratitis with vestibular auditory dysfunction and other systemic features. And Windewang's, that is cervico-ocular auditory syndrome. But the most important in this is the Usher's syndrome, as this affects 50% of the deaf and the blind population. Now, Usher's syndrome is combination of sensorineural hearing loss with retinitis pigmentosa with balance disorder in some. It is an autosomal recessive condition, and it is present in, it is of three types, of which the type 1 is the commonest. The type 1 child presents with profound congenital hearing loss with visual loss, which presents in this first decade, and abnormal, that is vestibular dysfunction, divided into types A to G, of which 1B is commonest. Type 2 presents with mild hearing loss, with later onset as the visual loss usually manifests in the second and third decades, and the vestibular function is normal in these children. Now the audiogram in the two types, type 1 presents with profound hearing loss, while type 2 presents with a typical spino pattern, that is mild sloping to severe sensorineural loss. And type 3 presents with variable degree of hearing loss and visual symptoms, with vestibular dysfunction and few. Now, irrespective of the types of Usher syndrome, all three have retinitis pigmentosa, which is degeneration of the rods and retina, which is responsible for night vision and peripheral vision. Thus, parents of these children come with history of that their child is not able to hear or not responds to sounds. The will give history of that the child is unable to sit or stand without support even after the age of 1.5 to 2 years, and gives history of tumbling at night. Now, histopathology shows malformation of cochlea, cochlear secondary dysplasia, and degeneration of spinal ganglion. Electronegativography and electronegativography are diagnostic of this condition. Now, it is very important to detect the hearing loss earlier in patients with Usher syndrome, as the ear has to take over the function of the eye. Thus, Usher syndrome and meningitis are two conditions in which the hearing loss has to be detected earlier, and cochlear implant has to be considered as early as possible. Now, next group of syndrome is deafness, which is associated with chromosomal aberration. In this, we have the Patau syndrome, which is trisomy 13, the Edwards syndrome, which is trisomy 17, and Down syndrome, which is trisomy 21. Now, these patients with chromosomal aberrations usually present with mental retardation, growth retardation, and specific dysmorphic features. Hence, an IQ test is very important to be done in these patients with chromosomal aberrations. Now, the most common in this is the Down syndrome, which is trisomy 21. A child with Down syndrome will have hypotonia, a flat face, upslanting eyes, epicanthal folds, abnormal ears, that is small ears with inner ear, with middle ear defect in the form of the fixed apes, protruding tongue, short fingers, a single palmar crease, that is the senior's crease, and gap between the first and the second toes, along with other systemic defects like mental retardation, cardiac defects like ventricular septal defects and gastrointestinal defects. Now, a patient with Down syndrome usually comes with conductive deafness, which may be due to, as these children are commonly susceptible to upper respiratory infections and sinusitis, which may lead to secretory otitis media and acute otitis media. These children may also have development abnormality like a fixed AP footprint, which may cause conductive deafness, while a few will have congenital sensorineural deafness. The next group of syndrome is the viral infections, which cause fetal damage and congenital malformation. Most common, the Torch complex, that is toxoplasma, rubella, cytomegalo, and herpes simplex, in addition to varicella zoster, syphilis, mumps, influenza, and measles. Now this group, Torch complex, presents with common symptoms of premature birth, growth retardation, neurological abnormalities, damage to eye, liver, heart, and ear, bone lesions, microcephaly, hydrocephaly, and psychomotor retardation. First in this is toxoplasmosis. A toxoplasmosis is a protozoal infection, and the pregnant lady gets the infection by ingestion of raw meat, and she can transmit the infection to the fetus. Now, risk of transmission is more in the first trimester, that increases with the period of gestation. It is 10% in the first trimester, 30% in the second trimester, and 60% in the third trimester. However, the severity of symptoms is more if transmitted in the first trimester. These patients have classic symptoms of classical triad, hydrocephalus, intracranial calcification, and chorioretinitis. Now, a child with toxoplasmosis may be asymptomatic at birth, then slowly develop visual loss due to chorioretinitis, may have sensorineural hearing loss of variable degree, may also have mental retardation, hydrocephalus, convulsions, intracranial calcification, small head, jaundice, and systemic features like hepatosplenomegaly, lung inflammation, heart inflammation, vomiting, diarrhea, cataracts, and may have intrauterine growth retardation. Now, diagnosis is made on the basis of general examination, ophthalmologic examination to rule out chorioretinitis, neurological examination, which also includes the hearing test, and CT scan to look for intracranial calcification, other inner ear and middle ear malformations, and toxoplasmo-specific IgM, TSF, is the specific test. Prenatal diagnosis is done on the basis of immunosynthesis with toxoplasma-specific IgM antibody in the cord blood and USG. Now, if a pregnant female gets an acute infection, this can be treated with spiramycin, and reports show that spiramycin helps to reduce the risk of transmission by 60%. If the newborn is affected with toxoplasmosis, he can be treated with a combination of pyrimethamine with the sulfonamide plus folinic acid, and which helps to reduce the severity of symptoms. The next in this group is the congenital rubella syndrome, which presents with classic triad of microcephaly, patent ductus arteriosus, and cataracts. A child with congenital rubella syndrome will have bilateral severe sensorineural loss, severe bilateral visual defect due to cataract, and corneal opacity. The risk of transmission is more during the first trimester, and at least 20% of these which are affected in the first trimester present with severe birth defects in the form of sensorineural deafness, blindness, congenital heart disease, microcephaly, in addition to hepatosplenomegaly and intrauterine growth retardation. 10-20% of these babies with the congenital rubella syndrome usually die within the first year, and 20% will survive, develop insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus as young adults. And these babies continue to shed the virus from their throats for up to 7 months to 1 year after birth. Now, diagnosis is made on the basis of virus-specific IgM antibodies in the neonatal serum, culture of rubella virus from infant urine and tissue, and prenatal diagnosis on the basis of administered IgM in the cord blood. Now, treatment is universal immunization with rubella vaccine should be done, and if the rubella virus is detected earlier in pregnancy, termination of pregnancy should be considered. The next is cytomegalovirus. Now, patients with cytomegalovirus, 90% of these patients are asymptomatic at birth, of which only 10 to 15% develop essential neural deafness, which is variable in severity. However, 10% are symptomatic at birth, of which 65% present with sentinel hearing loss, which is severe to profound. Now, these patients present with malaise, fever, lymphadenopathy, and hepatosplenomegaly, and diagnosis is done on the basis of viral culture and specific antibody testing. Treatment is done with acyclovir, ganciclovir, and fosmanogepix.